Good morning, everybody. Happy Resurrection Sunday to you. Let's all stand together this morning. He is risen. He's risen indeed. Praise God. Welcome to the house of God today, St. Simon's Christian Renewal, here in person as well as Facebook Live. We're honored that you'd give of your time to be with us today. We're here for one reason, and that is to lift up the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Bible says in Matthew 28, verses 5 and 6, "But the angel answered and said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen.' And he said, 'Come, see the place where the Lord lay.'" Aren't you glad that he's risen today and he lives? Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you, Lord, for today. We thank you, Lord, for your presence, for your anointing, and for God, that this time that we have to celebrate Jesus Christ, our risen, living Savior. We thank you, Lord, for all of your blessings. Pray, God, that you'll anoint every ear today, that we hear your word, that as we worship you, we draw closer to you. Fill our hearts with your spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. You'll hear the sound of a shofar, and let's worship the Lord together.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way. I once was fatherless, a stranger with no hope. Your kindness waking me from my sleep now. Your love it beckons deeply, a call to come and die. By grace now I will come and take this life, take your life. Sin has lost its power, death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen, victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. My dead heart now is beating, my deepest stains now clean. Your breath fills up my lungs, now I'm free, now I'm free. My dead heart now is beating, my deepest stains now clean. Your breath fills up my lungs, now I'm free, now I'm free. Sin has lost its power, death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen, victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way.
No more shame.
Lift my hands and spin around, see the light that I found. Oh, the marvelous light the marvelous light. Lift my hands and spin around, see the light that I have found. Oh, the marvelous light, the marvelous light. One more. Lift my hands and spin around, see the light that I have found. Oh, the marvelous light, the marvelous light. Marvelous light, I'm running out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross, you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. Into marvelous light, I'm running out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross, you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way.
Good morning. Happy Resurrection Day.
Oh,
gives way to victory.
I see the light of glory, and I know He lives. Me, because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Me, is Lord.
family, your children, their children, their children. May his favor be upon you in a thousand generations. Your family, your children, their children. Nothing can stand against God's favor, amen.
Wow, God's presence is thick this morning, isn't it? Lord, we just love you so much, Father. We just adore you. God, we thank you for your presence that we feel this morning. God, I thank you, Lord, that we can come into your house, God, and we can just forget everything that's troubling us, Father. I thank you, God, that we just can lay it on the altar, that we can give all of our troubles and our concerns to you, Father. And God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we lift up the needs that are represented in our bulletin. God, we lift up Mike and Laura Malavan, Susan Adams, Ann Johnson, Pam Brown, Pam Davis, Heather Dowdy. God, we ask that you bring healing to these bodies, Lord, in the name of Jesus. God, we ask that you just bring deliverance, God, and healing. God, we ask that you just break chains of bondage this morning, Lord. God, we just worship you, Lord. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you sent your Son to die on that cross for us, Lord, that we can have salvation and healing, Lord. God, we just worship you today, God. God, I pray that you'll just bless everyone here today. God, I pray that you'll bless every family represented here today. In your precious holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. Resurrection Sunday, he is risen. Amen. The greatest event of all time, of all history, is our living Savior, Jesus Christ. He is risen. Thank you for joining with us today, first-time guest. We want to say welcome to the house of God. So glad to have you with us today, Christy's mom and dad, missionaries in South Florida. Thank you all for being here. Pray God's blessings on you in a special way. I believe someone came today for encouragement, and the Lord has an encouraging word for you today. You'll see in your bulletin, if you didn't get a copy, they'll have a copy in the foyer there. There's some upcoming activities that we'd love for you to be a part of and be part with us as we fellowship together. And as we continue to be safe and wise and follow the Lord during this time. I want to draw your attention to a little insert that maybe you received in your bulletin today. If not, it's on the table there in the foyer as well. There are many things going on in our government today that in the past, in the 60s and the 70s, things were changed and we the Christians weren't necessarily as much a part as we should have been. And so things were changed in our country, and I believe that today we're to stand up as Christians, as Christ followers. And there's a bill before the Congress, and there are some changes proposing to be made May 17th. I believe there was a meeting to continue in H.R. 5. And the harm in this is that Jesus Christ paid for our equality. There's no better equality than what Jesus gave us. And so I believe we as a church need to follow after the same equality that Jesus gave, and that was that he loved every person. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world." The same love that Jesus portrayed then on the cross and went to the grave and rose the third day, as we celebrate that today, the same equality that Jesus portrayed then, he portrays now, today. And every living person should be loved the exact same way that Jesus loved in that day, today. We're followers of Christ. As you heard me say the last 4 weeks, talk about the voice of God and knowing the voice of God and following him, that's what we're called to do. And that is to love one another. Our love should not be limited one person over the other person. If you know me personally, you know me and my wife, we love every person. Try to do that just like Jesus did. And I find in my Bible that the only problem that Jesus had with certain people were the ones that were telling him what to do and how to do it, rather than him giving the word of God, his Father, to us for us to follow after. Those were, I believe, Jesus' probably greatest challenges was during that time. But Jesus met those that, even at the well, that had sinned and brought those before and asked them to cast the first stone if you were without sin. We're none without sin. And so the Bible says that he's no respecter of person. That doesn't mean that he puts one person over preference of another person. He loves each one of us. And I believe that the love that Jesus gives us, every living person, then and now and will, that we need to portray the same love. And our love for people is not based on what they do or what they don't do, but our love for them is based on what Jesus Christ has done and is doing. In with that, there's also truth. And the truth in the Word of God. The truth in the Word of God. It's interesting, as I was taking my my little two Dachshunds out early this morning and walk them around the backyard. They're boys. And they're boys and they're girls. And Christ gave life through male and female. And the very life that he gave, he wants us to live and to serve him through that and in that. And the Bible also says, as we read last Sunday, that confusion doesn't come from God. Confusion comes from the devil. And so if there's any confusion in our nation today, in our world today, it doesn't come from Christ. Jesus isn't confused. But we know that confusion slips in many times and confusion takes over and causes us to think confusion and blame Christ for it. But Jesus is not confused today. And I believe that if there's any confusion, we need to recognize where the confusion comes from, and the confusion does not come from Jesus Christ. And we see that there is confusion in our nation today. And I believe that if you will read through the, we're not telling you how to vote or what to do, or all we're doing is preaching the Word of God. And whatever the Word of God says, that's what we want to stand by. That's what we want to convey. That's what we want to speak and to live and to carry out is the voice and the Bible and the Word of God. And so I love you so much that I not only love you, but I also want to tell you the truth. You know, if I didn't tell little Bailey the truth, if I just loved her so much that I didn't even speak truth to her, that's not true love. Love also involves truth. And there's one truth that we stand on today, and that is the truth of the Word of God and the living Savior Jesus Christ. And so I want to encourage you, as you pick this up and as you read through and see what H.R. 5 is about, look and compare what we're seeing today, compare it to the Word of God, which is our truth. The Bible says that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And so he's our only guide. He's our only plumb line. Doesn't matter what my opinion is. Doesn't matter what I think or how I feel. But what matters is what Jesus Christ says. And I have found that every time that I come back to the Word of God, and no matter how I feel or where I'm at, if I balance my life back to the Word of God, there's freedom in that. There's peace in that. There's no confusion. There's love. And there's a future. Christ says that he came to give us a future. So I want to encourage you today to look and see what this is. And there's a call to action, I believe, that we as the body of Christ need to come to. And we didn't like the fact that Bibles were taken out of school. But we sat back that prayer was taken out of school. And we need to be active. We need to be involved and to know what's going on. Not to be political, but to be truth-bound. To be found on the Word of God. That's all. We're not running for office, but we're running for Jesus Christ. Amen. He's all that matters. And I would encourage you, as you've got an outline there in the foyer, read that, look at that, see what action that you can be a part of, and we want to help you with that. We want to help you to let's stand on the Word of God, let's proclaim the Word of God. And I found those that are having difficulties with this, I love you so much that I would love to spend time with you and to read and tell you what the Word of God says and to pray with you and show you that I love you and not just up here to preach and point fingers, but we're in this together. We're following Christ together. We love each other. We need to lift up each other and encourage each other. And that's part of this today. Do y'all receive that? Amen. Amen. I love you. Thank God for you. Thank God for you being here today. Well, today's a special day. It's my pastor, Pastor Bill Ligon, whom I've been part of his ministry and what God's called him to do for many, many years. Chris and I stepped into Christian Renewal Church back in the mid-90s in a time that we were hurting and aching, and God led us there. And you've probably heard my story, the very Sunday that the Lord led us there to Christian Renewal Church of Brunswick, there with Pastor Ligon and I call her Mama D, but Miss DJ Ligon. The Lord he led us there, and that's where we found home. And we stayed there and worked and was raised up under the ministry, the direction of Pastor Ligon. And he's been such a blessing and encouragement in my life and Crystal's life. And it was a few months ago, that I asked Pastor Ligon about sharing with us on a Sunday. And he's a busy man. He might be a retired, quote unquote, but he's a busy man. And I plan on being just as busy when I get his age as well. But he's been such a blessing in our lives. And there are many people that call the church and want to know where Pastor Ligon is and Mama, Miss DJ, where they are and what they're doing. And they're everywhere. He's involved in a church now out of town, helping it to get back on his feet and to be an encouragement to them. And they're very much a part of our life. And so we got our calendars together. And just so happened that today was the day that worked out for our schedules for Pastor Ligon to come and share. So I'm honored today to welcome my pastor, Pastor Bill Ligon.
To listen to the old man today. God bless you. What an honor it is to be here with you. And I'm so grateful that your pastor invited me to speak to you this morning on this Resurrection Day. Isn't it wonderful? Yes, and I've got my little bride with me. You know, she stayed with me 63 years now. That's quite a time, isn't it? I went to her church 64 years ago to preach a revival, and first service she came out with a choir and started playing the organ, and I forgot my sermon. She's been distracting me ever since. What a joy it is to be with you. Isn't this a wonderful day? Yes. Resurrection Day. Oh my goodness. I want to tell you that the Lord plans for you to be equipped, not just for Resurrection Day, but for resurrection life. God has a plan for you in the resurrection. Fact is, when Jesus returned and to see his friends, and he found out that his friend Lazarus was dead, this one of the sisters was talking to him, and she didn't understand all that was going on, and Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life." Jesus is the resurrection and life. And if you have Jesus in you, if you have believed on him and you've received him into your life, you have Jesus, and if you have the Holy Spirit in you, you have resurrection, life, and power within you. Are you ready to be equipped for resurrection life? It means that you'll receive the blessings that the Lord Jesus Christ placed upon his apostles. You know, when Jesus called his 12 together, in Matthew chapter 4, he said, "Follow me and I will make you to be fishers of men." And then in chapter 5, he began his 3-year training program with those men by speaking blessings over them. The Lord will do that to you. He will impart his blessings into your life. You will be taught by the Holy Spirit to live the Christian life, according to John chapter 14. You will be given new life, which we call being born again. And you will be filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with supernatural power. And when you're ready for this, the gifts and the fruit of the Spirit will operate in your life. All 9 gifts and all 9 fruit of the Spirit will operate in your life. Now let's look at this journey that Jesus carried his disciples on. A 3-year journey after he called them and said, "Follow me and I'll make you to be fishers of men." Let's look at that journey to see what led them to the place that the same supernatural anointing and power that rested upon Jesus operated in them too. And his intention and plan was that it would operate in you too. You would too know the power of God, the Holy Spirit, leading to a life of resurrection power and victorious living. It is all for you. So Jesus not only took his 12 disciples on that journey, but he will take you on the journey too. Are you ready for a 3-year journey taking place in 30 minutes that will prepare you supernaturally to live the overcoming life victoriously? You can. You can do it. It belongs to the Lord, right? In Matthew chapter 5, after Jesus called his disciples together, the first thing he did for them was to speak blessings over their lives. We call it them the Beatitudes. In Matthew 5:3, we have the first blessing that he spoke over them, and I speak it over you now. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, if you exegete that, you'll find out that it means blessed are those who are totally surrendered to the Lord, for they will experience kingdom living. The resurrection life, the supernatural power of God, will be released through you for the good of others around you. In Matthew 5:4, he said, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Are you ready for this one? One who mourns is a person who becomes convicted that your sins, past and present, have grieved God, grieved Jesus, grieved the Holy Spirit. And the reason Jesus suffered so terribly at the hands of the soldiers and the Pharisees and died on a cruel cross for one reason, because he loved you so much that he was ready to redeem you and forgive you of all those sins. Every sin, past and present, that you and I ever committed has been made atonement for through the blood of Jesus on the cross. And the Lord is blessing you that you will experience freedom, absolute freedom from all sin in your life. Not that you'll be perfect here, but that you'll be cleansed and covered with the righteousness of Jesus. One more of those, and then we'll move on from the Beatitudes. He said, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, one who is meek is one who is obedient. If you have trained your dog to fetch a ball or a stick, and you tell him to sit, and you throw the stick, but instead of sitting, he breaks and runs to get the stick, he is not meek. And if you have not learned to listen to the Holy Spirit so that you only move when the Holy Spirit says, go, you're not meek. But if you say to your dog, sit, and you throw the stick, and your dog is there, and every muscle in his body is moving, but he doesn't move his paws, he stays there until you say, fetch. And then he breaks and runs because he is meek. He is obedient. He does what the master says. The Lord has a journey for you and me to come to the place that we will obey the Holy Spirit. When he says sit, we'll sit. And when he says fetch, we'll fetch. We'll do whatever he tells us to do. And then, in verses 13 and 14, Jesus did something awesome for his disciples. He declared success over them twice. Now, these men were not even born again yet. They could not be born again until Jesus died for them on the cross. But Jesus said to them, you are the salt of the earth. Now, if I had been working with those men and he had said, Bill, you train them, and I didn't understand what Jesus had done, I would probably say, look, men, you're not. And if you try hard enough, maybe someday you'll be. If you don't change, though, you'll never make anything out of yourself. But Jesus didn't do that. He said to them, you are. And they became the salt that preserved and purified and changed the world around them. That's your journey. That's his plan for you. A number of years ago, a mother called me at the Christian Real Church in Brunswick, and she was crying. Her son had just come home with his report card. He was a seventh grader with all F's. It was worse than that. The child was repeating the seventh grade. He failed it the previous year. She said, "We don't know what to do with him, Pastor. We've warned him that he doesn't change, he'll never make anything out of himself." I said, "Well, you and your husband ring him and come to my office." So they did. And I taught them to do what Jesus did. Jesus said, "You are. You're salt." In the next verse, he said, "You're light. You're the light of the world." I had them pray and ask God to show them all of the potential in their son. And they wrote down all of the character qualities that could surface in their son's life. And then I told them, I said, "Now every day you lay hands on your son and you bless him and say, 'You are. You are, you are.'" And I taught the boy, I said, "Jesus said to bless those who curse you." And really, your parents, in sincerity, have been trying to help you, but they've been cursing you to failure. I said, "Now, I want you to bless your parents." So I taught him to bless his parents. I said, "Now, I can't get to your teachers at school, but I'm going to write out a blessing for you for your teachers." So I wrote out his blessing, and I had him memorize it. I said, "Now, tomorrow, when you go to class," and I said, "When you change classes every hour," I said, when you approach the teacher, go into the room, you approach the teacher's desk, "May I speak to your teacher?" "What is it, troublemaker?" I said, "Well, I'm just sorry for the way I've acted in your class, but you're an excellent teacher. May God raise you up to be the star teacher in this school. May you succeed in everything you do, and may you always be a success and advance in every way in your life. Come back tomorrow afternoon and tell me what happened." So he came back and I said, "How did it go?" He said, "Every teacher accepted my blessing but one." "What did she say?" She said, "I don't believe a word you say. You're a liar. You've caused nothing but problems in my class. You'll never make anything out of yourself. You'll always be a failure. I don't want you here." "What did you do, son?" "I did what you said, Pastor." I said, "I'm sorry for that, ma'am. But you're an excellent teacher. May God raise you up to be the star teacher in this school. May the favor of God rest on you in everything you do." I said, "What did she do?" She said, "Are you serious?" "Yes, ma'am." "Well, I guess we can try again." That boy broke the power of the curse over his life, just like Jesus taught his disciples, "You are." And he finished that year with all A's and B's, graduated from Brunswick High School with all A's and B's, later on decided he wanted to try to fly. He was so good at flying, he eventually got a job flying cargo jets around the world. That's the boy that the parents and the teachers said they'd never make anything out of themselves. And that's what some people have been saying to some of you. If you don't change, you'll never succeed. And I say, the Lord Jesus has taken you on a journey where you will succeed. You will have life. Now, the next thing Jesus does for you, just like he did for his disciples, he breathes into you his life. After Jesus was crucified and raised from the dead, as we celebrate today, the disciples were locked up in a room for fear of the authorities. They were not sure about Jesus. Jesus appeared in that room. And in John chapter 20 and verse 21, it says that he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." When he breathed on them, they were born again. You see, they could not have been born again until Jesus had made atonement for them 3 days earlier as he was crucified on the cross. But he breathed on them now and imparted that life to them. That life is yours. Isn't that wonderful to know? Cleansing us of all of our sins, forgiving us of all of our sins, breathing into us the gift of eternal life. Just take a deep breath right now and say, Thank you, Jesus, that I'm born again. Jesus, you're my Lord and my Savior, and you're imparting to me resurrection, life, and power. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Oh, I'm not supposed to be singing here, am I? I'm preaching, right? Glory to God. You are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. John 3:3, Jesus told Nicodemus, who was one of the religious leaders, but he wanted to talk to Jesus, and he slipped around to him by night so no one would see him. And he started talking to him, and Jesus said to him in John 3, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You won't know God's holy power that operates in resurrection life in the kingdom if you're not born again. Might as well forget it. In verse 6, he said, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Oh, my goodness. Isn't that wonderful? The next. Are you ready for this journey? Where's it going to take you next? He will empower you to minister to other people in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. After Jesus breathed into those disciples and said, receive the Holy Spirit, just before he was taken up into heaven, in Luke 24:49, it says that Jesus said to them, behold, I am sending forth the promise of my Father upon you, but you are to wait in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Now you need to say, Lord Jesus, I want all of it. Not only do I thank you for forgiving me and redeeming me and breathing into me the gift of eternal life, but I ask you now to clothe me with your power, to baptize me in the Holy Spirit so I can experience your glorious power. Oh my goodness. Back in 1965, my wife and I were pastoring in Valdosta, Southern Baptist Church. And the Lord spoke to us and told us that it was time to go to the mission field. So we applied with the Southern Baptist Foreign Mission Board and were appointed and commissioned and sent to Spain as missionaries. Had two little boys, a four-year-old and a 10-month-old. And during our sixth year that we were out there, I was a professor in the Baptist Seminary in Barcelona, Spain, and planting churches all throughout that area of Spain. And something that just threatened me terribly happened. Jesus, I wasn't there when it happened. A woman laid hands on my wife, and Jesus baptized my wife in the Holy Spirit. And she began to speak in tongues. She didn't tell me about it. She also was healed supernaturally in all of that time right then of stage 4 cancer. Confirmed by the physicians. Totally healed. She's never had it since, that type of cancer in her body. Finally, one day I said, honey, what has happened to you? You just seem so different. You just seem so peaceful. And she said, you better sit down and I'll tell you. So I sat down and she said, I need to tell you that Raquel laid hands on me and prayed for me, and I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and I have been praying to the Lord in another language. I've been praying in tongues. I said, you have? Listen, don't you know what they'll do to us if people find out? We're history. We'll be fired. The Foreign Mission Board will fire us. we'll be sent home for this. And she said, well, that's up to you. I'll leave it up to you. You take care of that. Well, I processed that for nearly a month, trying to think, Lord, what in the world? What do I do with this? You see, I was a Pharisee. I was trained and taught in college and seminary that baptism in the Holy Spirit and tongues ended when the church was formed and the canon of Scripture was established, that it was all over. We didn't have that anymore. So I thought, Lord, what am I going to do? We didn't have class on Monday at the seminary, so one Monday morning, my wife said, I'm going to go up to the seminary and work in the library and catalog some books. And I said, and the children were heading for school. I said, well, where do you pray? She said, I pray in the guest bedroom. Are you ready? This may happen to you. I went in that bedroom and got on my knees and I said, Lord, I don't understand all of this. I'm so confused. I love my wife dearly and it's just so wonderful to see what's happening in her life. You've healed her of cancer. She's just filled with so much peace and love and joy. What is this thing about baptism in the Spirit and praying in tongues and gifts of the Spirit? And all of a sudden, there was an atmospheric change in the room. And I came under a heavy baptism of fire for 2 hours. John the Baptist said, I baptize with water unto repentance. But there's one who comes after me who baptizes with the Holy Spirit and fire. You see, when the Lord wants to baptize a sweet little girl like my wife in the Holy Spirit, it's a very gentle thing. But when he's dealing with an old Pharisee, he's like he did Saul of Tarsus, he's got to knock him down, blind him, shake him up, and get his attention in, and then fill him with the Spirit. So the Lord came upon me and knocked me down, and I trembled under this power of anointing of great fire that was on me. I found myself confessing sins that I'd never even thought were sins, arrogance, pride, criticism of others, judgment, all of those. Lust, I said, Lord, I'm not committing adultery. He said, no, but I've seen you looking at other women. I said, Lord, I repent. I'm so sorry. I ask you to forgive me, Lord. Cleanse me, Lord. 2 hours of fire upon me, baptism of fire. And after that, the joy of the Lord came on me, and Jesus baptized me in the Holy Spirit. And I began to worship him and praise him and thank him. I had difficulty with tongues, and so I just began to pray in Spanish. But I was teaching in Spanish in the seminary. I was preaching in Spanish in the churches. You see, the reason I had a challenge with it, my father was a high school teacher. And when I was a little boy about like Bela's age, when she was up here singing, when she was singing this morning, I thought, how am I going to follow Bailey with what she did? But anyway, I was about that age, and I was walking around the house, and I was thinking about Jesus, and I was mumbling and other sounds. And my father heard me, and he called me to him, this high school teacher, and had me stand before him, and he said, son, I don't want to ever hear you mumble again. He said, now you speak clearly and enunciate your words and speak in English. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And so the very thought of me speaking utterances out of me that were not English, that I was not in full control of, was not for me. So I began to pray in Spanish until one day I had a challenge in my life. And I didn't know how to deal with it. And the Lord spoke to me and said, I've given you a way to let my spirit pray through you. And all of a sudden it dawned on me, that's what tongues is. He has equipped me for the Holy Spirit to pray through me in a heavenly language that I haven't learned. And I began to pray, and as I prayed more and more, I found myself under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The power of God was working in me. And the problem that I have, the Lord solved. He took care of it as the Holy Spirit had prayed about that. That's why God wants to equip you and me with another language that we haven't learned. You see, His plan in this journey for you and me is that we would be filled with the Holy Spirit, and not only would we be able to pray to God as the Holy Spirit prays through us, but all of the other gifts of the Spirit would operate in us also. The prophetic, all of the gifts, healing. Oh my goodness, all that God wants to do. One of the things that God did to show me that the gift of healing would operate, if I would let Him work through me, I wore horn-rimmed glasses to read and drive. And in 1973, I had to renew my driver's license. We were here in Brunswick at that time. And I was walking into the Highway Patrol Station to take the eye test, and the Holy Spirit said, leave your glasses in the car. I want to show you one of the reasons why I baptized you in the Spirit. I want to show you how healing operates. I said, but Lord, if I do, I won't pass the eye test. And it came again. You see, when the Lord speaks, it's very gentle and loving and soft. When the devil speaks, it's rude and harsh and mean. Okay, but the Lord speaks with gentleness and love. And He spoke to me gently again and said, leave your glasses in the car. I said, yes, sir. And I went back, locked my glasses in the car, and went in and put my eyes in that machine and read everything they put in front of me. And that was the last time I ever wore glasses. And every time I've had to take the eye test to renew my license, I've passed it every time. And I still don't wear glasses. And God has a plan for you and me too. I want to tell you, He wants to commission you to a journey like He did His disciples. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Do you hear Him saying that to you? Jesus is saying, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. I will make you a fisher of men. I will equip you. He'll do the empowering. He will redeem you. He will cleanse you. He will forgive your sins. He will pour His Spirit out upon you. He will empower you. He will fill you with the Holy Spirit and give you all the gifts of the Spirit in your life there for you. And that's what He did for me. And I believe it'll still happen. We're on a journey. You're commissioned of the Lord. When I was 80, that was a few years ago. I mean, you don't mind, do you, that a 90-year-old man is talking to you today? Is it all right with you? Huh? You sure that's okay? All right. Is it all right with you, huh? One of you men want to arm wrestle? Anyway, my doctor sent me to Emory for a physical. And this doctor completed the physical, and he said, hey, you're in pretty good shape for an 80-year-old. I said, thank you. I know exactly how long I'm going to live. He said, no one knows that. I said, look, doctor, I want to tell you something. I'm on divine assignment. I'm commissioned. The Lord called me to do His work, and I'm commissioned for His divine purpose. I'm born again and filled with the Holy Spirit, empowered. And I tell you this, when the Lord says, your mission is over, I'm out of here. So it could be right now before you finish this exam. And I could go into heaven. but I'm here, but I had need to ask you a question, doctor. He said, what's that? I said, what about you? Are you where the Lord wants you? Are you doing what the Lord wants you to do? He said, well, I'm a Methodist. I said, I like Methodists. Those are nice people. But in my Bible, I don't find anything in the Bible says that if you're Methodist, you'll go to heaven. You've got to be born again. You must receive Christ into your heart. And right there in that examining room, that doctor, very gracious man, received the Lord Jesus Christ and was born again. I said, now, doctor, I want to tell you something. The Lord has started you on a journey. Stick with him. Listen to the Holy Spirit, and he will lead you all the way in everything that he wants you to do. And that's for you too today. What about you? Are you confirmed? Are you commissioned? Are you ready for what God wants you to do? This is Resurrection Sunday. That means that Jesus, who is resurrection and life, is alive and living. And he did something special. He said to his disciples, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Holy Spirit will not come. But when I go away and the Holy Spirit comes, he will lead you into all truth. Expedient that Jesus go away. You see, when God limited himself in the person of Jesus, he also limited him to being in one place at one time. If he was speaking down by the Sea of Galilee, the people over in Jerusalem said, hey, we've got to go over there to hear him. But Jesus is here now. And he'll go with you and me wherever we go in the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, he will teach you all things and bring you to your remembrance everything that I've ever taught you. The Holy Spirit is here. You see, God is one. Only one God. We know him as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he enlightens the ministry and the life and the redemptive work of Jesus for you and me. It is for you. You just yield yourself to him, and the Holy Spirit will do his work in you. Oh, glory. Are you ready? Are you ready for that journey with the Lord? Redeemed, baptized in the Holy Spirit, equipped with fruit and gifts of the Spirit, to fulfill God's divine purpose in your life, to do all that God has told you to do. That's for you. He did it just for you. Listen to Romans chapter 6 and verse 5 to what Paul wrote. If we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. If we have been united with him in the likeness of his death, surrendered to him, absolutely surrendered, submitting ourselves to him to be forgiven and cleansed, receiving Jesus into our hearts as our Savior and Lord. If we've done that, then he is ready to equip us and empower us and give us the joy of resurrection life. I'm going to close with this. I was the youngest of five. And the same year that I graduated from high school in Birmingham, my father retired and moved mother and me and himself to Tallahassee, Florida, and enrolled me in Florida State University. I went for a year and a half. When I was 19, I thought, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I was a Christian. I had asked Jesus into my heart. We were members of First Baptist Tallahassee. And I thought, what am I going to do? And my neighbor, who was a retired naval commander, said, Bill, he said, why don't you join the Navy and you'll just be there long enough to know what you're supposed to do. So I said, well, that's a good idea. So I did. And the Sunday before I left on Monday in First Baptist Tallahassee, a big old church seated 3,000, 4,500 members, the Lord spoke to me and he said, this is your problem. You asked me to give you my life, but you haven't given me your life. You asked me to forgive your sins and come into your heart, but you haven't given me your life. You're still in control. And I went forward in that big old church. And the pastor said, why are you here, Bill? I said, Doctor, I'm here to say, I'm giving Jesus my life. I'll do whatever he wants me to do. He said, well, what are you supposed to do? Be a pastor, a missionary? I said, I don't know, Doctor, I don't know. I'm just saying, whatever it is, I'll do it. Can you say that? Whatever the Lord wants me to do, I'll do it. No matter what it is, I'm yours, Lord. I'll do it. I left the next day. 3.5 years later, I was dismissed honorably. Went back to college and finished my college. And 7 years from the date that I stood at that man's altar and said, I'll do whatever the Lord wants me to do, Lord. He called me and he said, Bill, I need you. I want you to be my assistant. And I went back to that same big old church as the assistant pastor and began my journey. Oh my goodness. Absolute surrender. It was the most wonderful revelation the Lord ever gave me then. To come to the place to say, Lord, I see what's wrong. I haven't given you my life. Now this morning, Pastor, I'm inviting your people to make sure that they give Jesus their life. That you'll come here and stand with your pastor and you'll say, Lord, here is my life. You gave me your life. You forgave my sins. You came into my heart. You filled me with the Spirit. But this morning, I'm giving you my life. I'm coming to you and giving you my life. If you're ready to stand with your pastor and his wife and come forward and stand with them, I'm going to speak blessing over you and pray. Little Bailey sang the blessing, but we're going to speak that blessing over you. You stand, come on down, just come on, Pastor. Stand up right now and come right on and just come up and say, here's my life, Lord. I'm giving you my life. Pastor, here come your people. Here come your people. I'm giving you my life. Take it. My life belongs to you. Surrendered to you. Absolutely surrendered. Oh, my goodness. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. What an awesome resurrection day. Yes, yes. 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 Oh, my goodness. Open your hands up to the Lord and receive from him right now. And say, Lord Jesus, I thank you that you gave me your life. Today, I give you my life. Take it. Use it for your glory. Whatever you want to do with my life, I belong to you. Come, Holy Spirit, take control. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, Lord. Pastor, just stay right here. Amen. Let's sing and worship the Lord.
Amen. Jordan, will you?
I just feel the presence of the Lord. Oh, I feel the presence of the Lord. is Resurrection Sunday. The glorious presence. God's doing something in every heart, every life here today. In Jesus' name. Oh my goodness.
Lord, we thank you for what you're doing today. We thank you that the very Spirit that raised you from the dead dwells in us today, Father. As we open our hands and our hearts to you, Father, we thank you that you fill us also with your Spirit today. God, we're nothing without you. We're lost without you, Father. God, we desire you to lead us and to guide us today. God, from this day forward, as we raise our hands to you, Lord, we recognize our weakness, but Lord, we see your strength. We can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. Lord, we need you today. We need you to fill our hearts and to fill our lives, Lord. Fill us, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If there's anything you have need of today, from salvation to healing to clarity, answered prayers, anything that's in your life, just raise your hands to the Lord right now. It's He who gives. And He said in His word, He gives freely to those who ask. So, Father, today we ask. Lord, you know what we have need of today. God, some need healing. Some need relationships mended. And some needs forgiveness. We need to forgive others, but Lord, we also need to forgive ourselves. God, whatever we have need of, nothing is too big for you. Nothing is too big for you. Lord, we lift it up to you right now. Thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord, for your Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for your peace. Thank you, Lord. I want to ask the elders if you would prepare the communion. We were to receive communion, but let's just stay right here. Let's just stay right here. This is such a sweet time, Pastor Ligon. Such a sweet time. I'm going to ask the elders, if you will, they'll come up and bring the communion, and it's all in one cup, the bread and the juice. And I want us to receive communion right now during this precious time. How many know God can change things however He wants to change them? We're not on our schedule, we're on His schedule. And what He does well. And we need to have that same attitude in our lives. Whatever you have need of today, let Him change it. Let Him change it up. It's okay. It's okay for Him to change it just the way He wants to. Thank you, Father. Jordan, sing. Go ahead and sing. As the elders pass out the juice here and the bread, just pass it around. Elder Rock, pass around Elder John. you've not received the bread and the juice, lift your hand if you've not received it.
Amen.
Is that anybody received? Bread up to the Lord. This is the body of Christ. As he gave his life, as he was spat upon, as he was bruised, as he was whipped, as he was beaten, as he hung on the cross, this bread represents his body. Take and eat. Thank you, Lord, for the price that you've paid. Juice represents the blood of Jesus Christ. As every drop of blood poured from his body, he shed it with you on his mind, with you and I. He gave his life, the very blood in his body that gave him life. He shed it for you and I. This juice represents the blood of Jesus Christ. Take and drink. Lord, we thank you that as we remember you, as we recognize our life comes from you, your body, your blood. God, it gives us life today. It gives us healing. It brings deliverance. Lord, you did it because you loved us and you forgive us today. Those who believe on Jesus Christ will be saved. And Lord, today we recognize that we need you and we believe in you. We believe on you. And Lord, now I pray that you'll cause us to confess you, to speak you, to live you. As Pastor Ligon said today, that we will have the resurrection power, your resurrection power, living and breathing through us, Lord. That will be a representation of you, of your disciples, that we believe and that we declare the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you that this is a new day. This is a day of resurrection, power, and life in and through you, Lord. It's not what we've done, but Lord, it's what you've done. Thank you, Lord, that we receive you. God, I pray for clarification. Thank you, Lord, that you're answering prayers even right now in this room, Lord. That you're bringing answers, just like you did with Pastor Ligon. God, as we look to you, God, you bring answers to those questions. You bring peace to those storms today. We declare it in Jesus' name. Come on, Jordan, lead us. Lead us. And we'll pray a prayer of closing. Sing it out. Blessing, sing the blessing. To the Lord.
nations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you, all within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going.
Thank you, Lord, for your spirit today. We thank you for your spirit, Lord. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your peace. We thank you, Lord, that your face does shine upon us, that your grace is upon us, your mercy, your love, your faithfulness, God. You said it's new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, God. You will never leave us nor forsake us. Somebody needs to hear that. He said he would never leave you. He will never forsake you. He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. Thank you, Father. God, you are awesome. God, you're awesome. God, I pray for every single person under the sound of my voice, whether in person or Facebook Live, I pray, God, for direction. I pray, God, for answers. God, not just this moment, but Lord, for this moment forward, that they'll feel your love, they'll feel your arms, God. You're not a God who hates. You're a God who loves. You're not a God who rejects. You're a God who accepts. You didn't give your life, Lord, to reject, but Lord, you gave your life because you love. Thank you, Father. I pray, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. God bless you. Love you. Thank you for being with us today.